Hello and welcome to our new series on the new normal. If there's one thing that's clear about this coronavirus pandemic, our world is changing forever. Fear is the new normal. Technological change, breaking new frontiers, is also the new normal. Dealing with uncertainty like never before is the new norm. Spending more time with our families is also the new normal. And as we change the way we live our lives, businesses around the world also must adapt to our current new normal. Today we look at Uber and what it's doing to face this not so brave new world. For the last 10 years or more, Uber has in so many ways been a revolution in our existence. But now the company has been hit hard by the new fear pandemic. How is it changing in India and globally to tackle this new normal? We are really fortunate to have with us Uber's global head, Dara Khosrowshahi, the man who brought a revolution within Uber financially as well as in the ethos of that company. Dara has always been a deal maker with a heart. But can he ensure Uber survives in this new world which threatens its very business model and its existence? Dara, thank you very, very much for joining us. It's really great to talk to you. You don't do this very often, even virtually. But hopefully one day soon we'll meet again in San Francisco. Thank you so much for sparing this time.
I look forward to sharing a walk, but in the meantime, our virtual meeting we'll have to do. Thank you for having me.
Dara, the world has been hit in so many different ways by this global pandemic. Everybody's world is transformed. In what way has it affected Uber?
Well, it has been a real shock to parts of our business. As you know, Uber really was started on the rides business. This is the business of moving people around in cities with either cars or autos, motos, etc., depending on the local means of transportation. And that part of the business, frankly, has been hit very hard. As cities close down, and they close down for good reason, our rides business really went to an almost stop. Yeah. We're seeing that business start to return. And the return is really closely associated with the opening of cities and societies, countries. But we took a hard hit. There was a point at which when we talked to investors where our rides business, which is really the profit generator of the group, was down 80% year on year. I couldn't imagine. I'm used to parts of our business being up 80%, not down 80%. But I think COVID and what it's done has been unprecedented in many ways.
So when the world changes as dramatically and as suddenly as it has done now, we all have to change too, right? How are you changing Uber to face this new normal?
The silver lining here is that we have also built over the last 4 years a food delivery business that has turned into the largest food delivery business, Uber Eats, in the world outside of China. We built it organically. Actually, we announced a big deal in that category. That category has grown very quickly. So we have actually an interesting hedge in that our rides business was hit by a shock that it's returning from. And our delivery business now has really had a boost, growing very, very quickly. Hopefully we can get the best of both worlds, both sides of the business growing after this crisis.
Now that's really a major, major change. Up to now, BC, that's before Corona, you would have been, say, 90% rides and 10% other businesses. Now looking ahead, what's it going to be like?
I think it's going to be 50-50. It's our delivery business is growing at rates that, frankly, I didn't think was possible. And we have doubled up on that. So we're augmenting the organic growth with acquisition as well. And I think we're cementing a real leadership position in what's going to be a very, very big market going forward.
So now 50-50 is Uber's new normal, 50% rides and as much as 50% home delivery. What a revolution that's going to be. But are you being too optimistic? Yes, for each one of us as customers, we've discovered in this pandemic that delivery at home is great. It's so easy. Why go all the way to a grocery store? You can get everything delivered right at your doorstep. But what makes you so confident that Uber can win in this increasingly competitive space? What's different or special about Uber that's going to make it a major player in the food delivery and grocery delivery business? What's special?
You know, the really, I think, cool thing about Uber as a technology company is while we are a global technology company, ultimately we are empowering local entrepreneurs, drivers, right, who are building up their own little businesses or local restaurants or local grocers or local supermarkets. And all of the economic flow essentially is in your city or your village or your neighborhood as well. So we think it'll be a big business, but it will be a big local powered business, which for us, especially during these times, you know, supporting your local restaurant, supporting your local small business, we think is meaningful.
Now you are a deal maker and you seem to have got your groove back now and you've done this huge deal. Now you've been talking to them for quite a long time and it suddenly happened. So Corona has really helped you close deals as well, is it? In this new world, in this crisis, is it helping us also to push deals quicker, upping the sort of urgency quotient?
Well, I think that while the news seems sudden, these are relationships that we built over a period of time.
Yes.
And I think Corona is a catalyst. You know, moments of crisis spur change in society and in business as well. And you know, sometimes when you have the world changing around you, it makes you ask fundamental questions. And the relationship that I built with Bastian over a number of years, I've known him, I've respected him as a competitor. He's the CEO of Postmates that we bought. It led to certain discussions. And the timing was right. You can never predict timing, but when the timing is right, you take advantage, you push, and you take a bet. And we certainly have, and we're pretty excited about it.
And the whole deal was done virtually?
All done, 100%.
You didn't?
I'm sorry?
You didn't shake hands, I hope.
We bounced virtual elbows.
Virtual elbows. Okay, that's the new way deals are signed. This is the new normal, is it?
Yes, yes, indeed.
Now, a big factor after the pandemic is this new normal of fear. People want to be extra careful and be safe. In fact, for businesses, ensuring safety for customers is no longer an optional extra. It's now essential, isn't it? Safety first is now actually a prerequisite to having a successful business. Isn't safety now integral to making profits?
Absolutely. And I think based on the kind of shock that has gone through the system, to some extent, the fear is understandable. Mm-hmm. The good news for us is that, and this happened when I first took over the company, we had a priority that we call standing for safety. And at the time, the definition of safety was much more about personal safety, especially women riding in Ubers or women drivers in Ubers, making sure that you got to enjoy a safe ride. So we have a team of business leaders and technology product leaders that are completely dedicated to safety. That's all they think about.
So the work and the focus of your safety team at Uber must have changed dramatically now. In addition to passenger and driver safety from attacks, there's a totally new fear now for the team to deal with, right?
Well, the definition of safety in a COVID world has changed, which is safety from the virus. And as we return from the crisis, what you have seen from us is a real leadership position in terms of making sure that, you know, kind of your second first ride on Uber, because that second time that someone says they're going to take an Uber is a big step. That second first ride is a safe ride. And we've really designed the app, almost redesigned the app from the ground up. Riders and drivers are required to use masks. We have selfie technology that was designed to recognize the driver to make sure you're getting the driver that you're signing up for. Now, not only are you getting the driver that you signed up for, but we're making sure that that driver is wearing a mask. Drivers can cancel if riders aren't wearing a mask. We have PPE distribution and sanitation hubs all over India to make sure that drivers are sanitizing their cars so that you get into a clean car. And we have actually innovated what we call an Uber cockpit, which is essentially a barrier that we started in our project with the NHA when we launched Uber Medic to get healthcare workers to hospitals, et cetera. It is a thin line to essentially separate the rider from the driver, and again, to keep both parties safe. So we think that those steps that we're taking and the innovations that we're driving on the safety front, masks, barrier, sanitation, will help society feel safe again to take that next step forward and hopefully let the cities open up, but open up in a safe way.
Yeah, it's really a difficult factor to counter, this fear factor, isn't it? So are you reaching out not only to your drivers, but to your customers as well and saying, don't worry, these are the steps we are taking. We are changing our technology a little bit. Are you making all this clear to people that this is the new normal?
We absolutely are. It's funny, actually, when it was not safe to move, we had on the app, actually, we launched we had a interstitial a message that said, hey, make sure if you're using an Uber, you're using an Uber for the right reason. It's the first time I had a team actually pitch to me a feature that was essentially saying, don't use Uber, which we approved. And at the time, it wasn't healthy to move around. And it was the right thing to do for a company. We were making a choice for safe society versus a choice for, let's say, better business or better financial results.
That's really amazing that at the peak of the pandemic, you said, don't use Uber. So what you're saying is it's no longer safety versus better business. In a way, the new slogan for everyone is possibly safety is good for business, right?
Now, when you open up Uber, the first thing that we communicate about is all the safety steps that we're taking so that both the rider and driver understand that it is about the safety of the platform first. And the safety of the platform isn't just a personal choice. It's a choice that you're making for the next person using the Uber or getting into an Uber. It's a community choice. So just as the PM is saying, be responsible for your society, we're also saying the same thing. Be responsible for your next ride. Be responsible for your driver. And the driver, please be responsible for your riders.
I must say that I'm working from home and I've never worked so hard in my life. People all around want the lockdown to end just so they can relax a bit. So do you find that people are just as productive as earlier, if not more productive? And will you relook at whether everybody needs to go to work physically ever again after the pandemic is over? The new normal, work from home.
We're finding that our programmers are actually more productive than they ever have been in terms of checking code, the amount of code that they're checking in. The productivity has increased. I also think that the productivity of our employees has increased because we're facing a crisis. People are working faster. Teams are coming together more quickly. Sometimes meetings that weren't meaningful, people aren't bothering to have these meetings. Like the business is moving very, very quickly now. And I think this crisis is going to teach us lessons. There are different ways of working. There are different ways of being productive. We should probably be more flexible in terms of folks if they want to work from home one or 2 days or they want to work from a different location. Right now, we are in the middle of the fight and it's hard to step back and have perspective.
Right.
But I do think that there are going to be some real lessons learned coming out of this crisis. And while it's not fun right now, I'll be honest with you, I think we will be a better company for it and we'll be a closer knit team as a result of it. And the funny thing about our becoming closer as a team is distance is the thing that's making us closer as a team. And I think we'll come out of this stronger. I'll have some more gray beards over here, but we as a company will come out of this stronger out of a crisis.
So what would you tell your shareholders and your employees about the future of your company? Are you going to be as profitable as you ever were, or is it going to be really tough times ahead for Uber?
Well, I think that because we have such a big business in terms of delivery, food delivery on a global basis, I think we're uniquely positioned here. We have an incredible balance sheet. It's a fortress balance sheet. And having a balance sheet like that, having we have over $8 billion of cash, allows us to be more aggressive and innovative and take risks in overall business. For example, you know, it's a risk to some extent telling people not to ride. It is a risk saying safety comes first before business. Right. The balance sheet allows us to make those kinds of choices. And what we've seen with the rides business is when cities open up, when societies open up, Uber opens up as well. And these are deeply uncertain times. I'll give you that. And even CEOs have their doubts, and even journalists have their doubts as well. But I do believe that society is going to open up. I believe that countries are going to open up. And I think that a rides business is going to return, and it'll return even stronger because some of the entities that don't have the kind of balance sheet that a company like ours has may not survive or may come out permanently weaker.
Yeah, there may be an argument that as this pandemic passes and the world gets a treatment or a vaccine, Uber rides will pick up in a V shape. But food delivery will not. It may, in fact, go the other way. So how do you forecast these demand and these behavioral changes?
You can't forecast it. You just position yourself to essentially perform in any market. And what you've described is a great hedge, right? If the rides business recovers more slowly, then our delivery business will continue to grow at accelerated rates. If the rides business comes back, then you could expect some slowdown on delivery, but I will tell you that the evidence shows delivery is a delightful product. You know, you push a button and your dinner shows up in 30 minutes, hot, ready to eat. You've got anything that you can choose from. You don't have to deal with traffic. You don't have to deal with parking sometimes, especially in the developed markets, et cetera. These are issues that you don't have to deal with, and you can eat at home. You can eat with your family. You can eat at your dinner table. So the evidence that we've seen with delivery is, yes, we think it's good for people to go out to dinner. We think we look forward to that day, but they're experiencing our Uber Eats products or Uber grocery products will stay with them, and they will become customers for life.
Now, one of the big changes in the near future, at least, is that people are worried about taking public transport. Again, fear of the various unknowns. Is that another area where Uber is going to benefit because people might switch from public transport to more personalized movement?
Well, we are, our view is public transport has to play a significant role in transportation going forward. Especially as it relates to avoiding congestion, avoiding pollution, et cetera. We have seen some evidence early on that there's been some switchover of public transport to Ubers. As you said, there's some people who are nervous, and they're rightly nervous about transportation going forward. But we want to be proponents of public transport. And we're actually building technology to power public transport in some cases. And also, for example, when you launch your Uber app, for us to show public transport choices.
So is there any part of the world where the number of Uber rides daily has actually bounced back to the pre-corona era?
We are getting very close in, for example, Hong Kong. It's getting very, very close to pre-corona levels. We're having positive now volumes in certain countries, not quite at pre-corona levels, but positive volumes as well. You look at a New Zealand, you look at Australia, for example, even France, the uptick in business is looking quite healthy, essentially as those countries and societies open up. So I'm pretty optimistic.
And what's the situation in India? Not yet back to pre-corona levels. Is it still much lower here?
I think India was a little slower to be affected. And is a little slower coming back. But I'll be honest with you, some of the tough calls that, for example, PM Modi has made those are necessary calls because you want the response and you want the rebound to be a lasting rebound. You don't want the up and down. And to some extent, you see it in the United States. You could argue that there are certain states that opened up too quickly that weren't careful. They're a little too carefree in their opening. And, you know, I'm optimistic about India. Yes, it is slower than some of the other countries, but I think the care is warranted.
Can you give us some examples, actual examples of environmental sustainability that companies like yours and others could and should do to make sure we don't go back to old bad habits?
One example for us is we've introduced an Uber Green service and we've started piloting that in Europe. Uber Green is essentially users requesting an electric vehicle because there aren't quite as many electric vehicles as there are gas power vehicles on the street. The time at which it takes to hail an EV is a little bit longer. Instead of waiting 4 minutes, you might have to wait 9 minutes or 10 minutes. But we're giving users the opportunity to request these special vehicles. That creates more demand for the EVs. And as a result, creates more demand drivers than if they see more requests coming for their EVs, they will then upgrade to an electric vehicle. So our launching Uber Green in Europe has been an example. In London, for example, we are taking a small fee from every single ride. We're putting it into a sustainable environmental fund that then our drivers can use to upgrade from a gas power vehicle to an electric vehicle as well. So there are a number of programs that we have in place. We're going to bring it all together to have our global sustainability strategy, which we'll have a lot more to say later this year. It's everybody's responsibility, including ours.
Sorry, now coming to the new normal in your personal life, tell us, how has your life changed, Dara?
I'm at home every night for dinner. I've become a much better cook. I'm cooking as well. You know, my wife and I, our evening time is sitting down and cooking. I man the grill and I help out as well. But, you know, I think my family's pretty happy. And I think while we have lots of challenges, I just can't, you know, you take things for granted. But times like this really make you appreciate the things that sometimes we take granted. And for me, I took granted sometimes those evenings with the family. And now for me, it's a treasure every single time.
Actually, don't tell anybody, but I'm enjoying this lockdown more than ever. Just like you, the positivity of being with family much, much more is actually wonderful. But actually, I'm a bit worried about your cooking. You may think it's great. I just need to double check once with your family.
You're invited anytime once I'm allowed to invite you physically. You'll be very impressed.
No, I just want to talk to your family about your cooking, but when you are not in the room.
The truth will come out.
Tell me, is this the biggest challenge you've ever faced in your professional career? Is this the biggest challenge?
Oh, yes, absolutely. I'll tell you, the Uber job is the biggest challenge that I faced, and Corona, you know, upped the challenge for us. But it's times like these when you're reminded that what you do matters. When millions of people want to get back on your service in order to start earning again, in order to make a living, in order to get to their job or get to the hospital. And so while it's a challenge, it also hits home that the work that we're doing is really important. And that's what gets me up in the morning, ultimately.
So you have at least three huge responsibilities. Uber drivers for theirs and their families' lives. Uber shareholders who are worried about their future. They've invested in you. And your own Uber employees all across the world. Can you give us one sentence for each of them?
For shareholders, I would say hold and you'll be rewarded. For our drivers, I would say we're going to make sure you're safe and we'll do everything we can to to continue to build earnings opportunities, but they have to be safe earnings opportunities. And for our employees, I'd say, I can't wait to see you in person and keep building.
Now, in the midst of this crisis, you're looking fresh and relaxed. So you're obviously sleeping well. But tell me, at the end of the day, as you turn in, what's your one big worry?
I'll tell you, I don't believe in worry. I think you know this. I'm an immigrant. I came my family came from Iran to the U.S. And we lost everything as in terms of financial means, and we had to rebuild everything. We were lucky enough to have enough for my parents to provide an education, but we lost everything financially. We always had each other as a family, and for me, I know my family's going to love me. I know they're going to be around. And worrying then doesn't enter into my lexicon. I've got to represent, I've got to be there for my teams. So when I go to bed, I go to bed, and I wake up fresh, and I get back to work.
And you're working harder than ever before?
I'm working, yes, I would say that's exactly right. I'm working harder than I ever have before. But this is a mission-driven company, and I wouldn't be doing anything else.
So finally, in this big crisis, what have you discovered about yourself personally that you didn't know earlier, good and bad?
You know, what I've discovered about myself is that it goes a little bit to what you and I talked about. I think I can be a leader who stands up to the challenge. And can represent an incredible company and millions of drivers and riders and represent them in a fair way and do so being proud of what I'm doing every single day. And I think that's fun. I think it's an incredible opportunity and it's a huge responsibility as well. And the thing that my wife says when I sit down for dinner is, I don't carry any of that burden when I come to dinner because I know that I've given it my all at work. And then I can be Dara. And when I have dinner with the kids, we talk about their, you know, what they did that day, what they read, what they're doing. In the end, when you sit down and have dinner with your family, you're a father, you're a brother. And you know, that's a thing that you can never forget.
So Dara, thank you very much for all your positive thoughts. And more strength to you.
Thank you very much. It was great to spend, at least for me, a little bit of my evening with you.
So now we do an elbow shake, right?